The White House has been seriously considering the establishment of a Space Force as a separate military department for at least a year, long before President Trump brought it up at a rally this past spring. Our next guest makes the case that militaries have long used space science and space-based technology to their advantage, while astrophysicists have reaped the rewards of such military investments. He chronicles the militarization of space in his latest book entitled Accessory to War, The Unspoken Alliance Between Astrophysics and the Military. Famed astrophysicist of the American Museum of Natural History and director, Hayden Planetarium, Neil deGrasse Tyson joins us now. Thank you very much for being on with us this morning.
Thanks for having me.
I guess, first of all, let's lay out the premise of your book. And is it based on how scientists and the military play off of each other?
Yes, but there are certain branches of science that are well known in their relationship with war. Physics, for example. Without physics, we wouldn't have had the atom bomb. Without chemists, we wouldn't have had mustard gas and napalm and other weapons of war, and the biologist might weaponize anthrax, for example, in conflict. But the astrophysicist, just historically, we're thinking, but we just sit at the mountaintop and wait for photons of light to come to us, and it's a pretty humble state of existence for us. And that's all true, but at the end of the day, if you look back over the centuries and even millennia, there's been this two-way street between what we do when we study the universe and what military conquest, hegemony, empire building has required of us. So you go far enough back, navigation around the world, all the great seafaring nations required knowledge of where they were in the world and where they were headed and where they came from, where the enemy was, where the friendlies are, and that required navigation that involved stars. And so astronomers back then were fundamental to this exercise.
So then it would seem that the development of a space force would make perfect sense.
Well, space force is not, you know, just because it came out of Trump's mouth doesn't mean it's a crazy idea. It's been around for a while. Just saying.
Good point. Clarify.
Just to clarify, it's been around for a while. No one today is questioning the value of an air force when during the Second World War, that was simply a branch of the Army. It was the Army Air Force. So the Air Force then separated apart, and then no one questions that then or today. Space is similarly different from air than air is from ground infantry. So it's not a crazy idea. I don't have a horse in this race. All space activities were previously or currently handled by the Air Force. There's the U.S. Space Command under the Air Force. Any space force would take all of that, remove it, and give it its own umbrella, and maybe add a few things. If I were to add a couple of things, I say, well, if you're doing that, throw in asteroid defense. I don't want to die like the dinosaurs did. You know, if the dinosaurs had a space program, they would still be alive today, I'm pretty sure.
It seems to me that there are other values that might animate the practice of the astrophysicist that may collide with the values that animate military folk? How do you think about those two?
That's a brilliant access point. And I would say about half this book addresses the conflict, the tension that we experience as astrophysicists. As a community, we are overwhelmingly sort of liberal anti-war, yet we are complicit when it comes to this exchange of technology. We recognize it's more just of a blunt reality. If we make a discovery that the military uses, we don't have much control over their adoption of it. If they make a discovery that would greatly help us, are we going to say no because it was used in warfare if it really helps advance our understanding of the universe? Generally, we don't.
We do have sort of a militarized environment in space, right? 2007, the Chinese took out a satellite, anti-satellite weaponry. We have a lot of dual-use systems in low Earth orbit that can be transformed into weapons pretty quickly. So do we face a system here where we're looking at sort of a 1950s, 1960s arms race style, where we don't have any diplomatic limits on this sort of thing, and we have to compete with each other in low Earth orbit, and we're facing a runaway conflict environment?
Yeah, another great question. First of all, the militarization of space, when we use that phrase, typically you're thinking of, oh, there's a bomb, there's a weapon, there's a laser. But I think you need to be a little more broad when you think of militarization. Ever since we had access to space, we were putting up communication satellites, reconnaissance satellites, satellites that are in the service, based spy satellites, in the service of geopolitical conflict. That's been going on from the beginning. In fact, Sputnik translates loosely from the Russian to mean fellow traveler. And it's Sputnik, remember, you read about Sputnik, 1957, October 4th, and Sputnik had a radio transmitter. It just went beep, beep. But there it was, over our heads. You need permission to fly through someone's airspace, but not someone's space, all right, the space above it. So there it was. And wait a minute, the military folks knew. That wasn't just any rocket. It was an intercontinental ballistic missile with a hollowed-out shell. And they swapped the warhead for the beep, beep transmitter. And that was a message. That's why we lost out. We freaked out.
Wow.
Okay. We freaked out. That's why. So there's not a new thing going on here. And by the way, no, you're not going to have weapons destroying satellites in space. You know why? Because you do that, your satellite becomes hundreds or thousands of pieces of broken hardware moving at 18,000 miles an hour that can take out your own satellites. It's the modern equivalent of trying to use mustard gas because you can't shoot the soldiers in the trenches, and you can't shoot them. So let's throw mustard gas. Oh, the wind changed. Oh my gosh, now it's coming back in our face. So space warfare is not so much weapons, but access to information. And the second Gulf War was completely enabled by space assets, alerting land, sea, and air invasions to where everybody is, where they're headed, where they're coming from, and where the targets are.
Okay, my mind is blown. The book is Accessory to War, The Unspoken Alliance Between Astrophysics and the Military. Absolutely fascinating. Neil deGrasse Tyson, thank you very much for being in our space. We will be right back with much more. Morning Joe.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories. And you can click on any of the videos around us to watch more from Morning Joe and MSNBC. Thanks so much for watching.